have that. We wanted to have the artists have the opportunity to express their own convictions in their own style. But we also wanted to tie the whole thing together and make it look as though the whole thing is one piece. And so we decided on using a logo. The words, "The struggle continues, La lucha continua," which is the title of the project, but translated into a whole number of different languages. And the idea in that was not only to have something that tied it together, but also, in a sense, to make the project even broader, because the specific focuses of struggle that we chose are just some of the struggles for liberation and for freedom, for justice that are happening right now in the world. And so we wanted to give it more of a worldwide context and translated the words, "The struggle continues," into many different languages. In the project, we worked with a local organization, Charas, which has its building, has an old school building that they've been given on the corner of 9th Street and B, and have been working in the community there as a cultural organization and a housing advocacy organization for actually since the 60s, for about 20 years. And since we were working in that community, we wanted to have the connection with local organizers so that we would not be jumping into the community and imposing our work on the people there without consultation. Now, this was a kind of a very thin line. It was a special project because one of the frustrations that we've had in doing community murals in the last few years is that when you go into a community, they tend to say they want something pleasant. They say, don't do anything controversial. We don't want anything that's going to cause trouble. If you go to a Puerto Rican community, they tend to say, don't paint anything about independence. We don't want to cause any controversy. So Joe and I, for example, have felt, and other people in the group, Camille and Hernando, have felt very frustrated at the fact that while in the early years of the mural movement, it seemed like our political convictions and what the community wanted merged together. In the last few years, on those murals where we're paid to go into an organization and paint a mural, usually they want something that's just pleasant. So in this instance, we were doing political art, and that's the reason why the artists donated their time. That's the reason why we worked, although we're professionals, we worked without getting paid on this particular project because it was our convictions. At the same time, we didn't want to impose our convictions in a place where they wouldn't be appropriate. So we worked with the community, and at first, as a matter of fact, when we first presented the proposals, people took a little exception to some of them and said, well, why do you want to paint all these things that are difficult, all these things that talk about bad things, that talk about trouble? Why don't you do something, you know, flowers and dancers, cultural things? And we said, well, we have some of that. But that we want to do this, and we explained about the project to them and worked together to select the proposals that were used in the actual project and also to make some changes. And the changes that were recommended were very, very interesting, because in most cases they were very appropriate and very apt to make the meaning a little bit more clear. For example, there's a beautiful piece that Keith Christensen painted underneath the mural where we're working of grass roots. And the image in that is a root which has the names of community and grassroots organizations painted on it. And in the original proposal, there was the root and above it was like a beautiful abstract flowering, a sky, which looked like it was flowering, but it was abstract. And when the community people, the people from Charis and a few others who looked at the designs with us that formed this local group that helped us to select the designs, then when they looked at that, they thought that it could be misinterpreted and that the flowering above could be seen as gentrification taking over. So, in fact, they recommended that we change the design of that in some way is to make it more clear. And in fact, what Keith did was to put the root on a background that was that abstract pattern, rather than have the abstract pattern coming out from the root.
Okay, so I hope you all enjoyed yourself and see the gallery with the community artists, the association gallery, and also the theater for the new city. Okay, I would like now to start introducing the next MC because I'm going to take a break. I would like to introduce the person that created the name, the poet that created the name Loisaida. The reason this comes, you know, the Puerto Ricans, we always have a hard time saying Loisaida before we learn how to speak English. You know, it took a poet to come and say, well, you know, if we cannot say Loisaida, let's invent a name that we could say. And out of the language Spanglish, a great poet came out from this community and invented a name, which since 1964, we wrote a play about it, Don Quixote Loisaida. And also, I would like to say, you know, that name has become the rhythm and the spirit of this community. Okay, and now the Loisaida, the poet that created the name Loisaida, I would like to introduce to you the great Bimbo Rivas.
Hey, all right. Golly, not only Chino, but a whole lot of people. And now, of course, the moment we've all been waiting for, the artist. Where are the artists? Eva, get over here. Wow. Woo! Whoa, there they come. Yeah, this is their day here. They made this here responsible. Whoa! Yeah! Yeah, even take over because there's so many beautiful people, you know them better than I do, and you introduce them to us so we can get to know them better. I want to be in the audience for this one.
You know, this is an amazing moment to me because it's been very hard to get this entire group of artists together. I see William. We could get together to do the painting and to do the work that needed to be done. It's been very hard to get us all together in one place at one time. So it's kind of a wonderful occasion just right at that to see all of these artists here together. The idea for working here in the Plaza Cultural to paint this series of murals came out of actually an inspiration. Roberto Vargas earlier talked about the murals in San Francisco on Balmy Alley, and we had a speaker come to Art Makers, which is our organization, a small murals organization that just was founded 2 years ago to provide murals for people in poor communities, murals that speak about their hopes, their lives, their aspirations, and their problems. And this man came and showed us these pictures of murals in San Francisco in an alley. And all these murals were painted by artists there about Central America. And we looked at that and said, how come they could do this in San Francisco? And here in New York, we don't have a project of beautiful political murals to talk about the issues that we all feel so deeply. So we started at that point with this little bit of a dream about somehow we could put that together. And we've been working with Charis, with Chino, to do some work here in the park, and decided that this, with the four buildings that there are, would be a perfect location. So we got together and began in May of this year to issue a call to artists of conviction to come together to do these murals, and we asked them to donate their time and to donate their talents to create murals on the theme of struggle, the struggles that are the same struggle, the struggle in South Africa, the struggle in Central America, the struggle here in the Lower East Side. I'm just overwhelmed by it, because when you start with an idea, a little idea, and you see it in little sketches on paper, it's very hard to conceive of how gorgeous it's really going to be when everyone completes their home murals and they really are there on the wall. And I'd like to introduce the artist to you, Marguerite Vanyan, who worked on the collective mural. Which worked together to create social change, and also did this wonderful program for us today, Keith. And Casanova, who's also in our mural. Ricky Asher from Arts for a New Nicaragua, who painted a mural of Nicaraguan and African and American women working together in the struggle, and who also this summer, after she finished that, and after she worked with us on the collective mural, went to Nicaragua and painted three more. Yeah. in the garden, and it's a mural about gentrification. Willie's lived here on the Lower East Side in this neighborhood on 6th Street, and he felt real strongly that he wanted to paint something about that. Together, and then designed and painted a fabulous mural in the garden about women, a feminist mural that talks about women and brings together the questions of women's equality, the Lower East Side, South Africa, and Central America.
Bone, and she looked at that scaffolding and she looked at all this stuff and just kind of pitched in and lent a hand, heaving stuff and raising it. And the first time she went up to the first level, she said, "I'm not getting on this thing." But before the project was over, I found myself constantly having to, like, you know, "Dorian, please don't hang off on the fifth level." But she had to go. She was here earlier and she had to leave. So also want to present you to Dorianne, even though she isn't here. And I want to take this opportunity to thank also some of the people who helped us out, who gave us, I want to thank especially, I guess, Jim Murray, who gave us the first contribution and the first sense that we could go ahead and really make a go of this project. And it seemed like this project was something that had to be, because every time we were desperate for money or materials or the weather, something came along and something happened and it all worked out. And I want to thank all the people listed here in the program, and especially Chino and the people at Charis, Angelo, Margie, all the people who had to open the door and close the door after us 10 times a day as we went in and out for our equipment.
Eva, with that thought in mind, Tata wants to say thank you also. And on behalf of Loisaida, our entire community, thank you. Thank you.
On behalf of the artists, we'd like to thank you all.
The highlight was the day of the fiesta. To see the murals as a backdrop for the poetry and the music, and just to see the joy in people's faces as they walked around and hearing comments like it's like an art gallery, and you know, that for me was the highlight, because it means that you're all the sweat and hassle and stress, that it paid off. Hopefully we hope it will have the effect of showing the ordinary person of the Lower East Side that what they're facing in their everyday battles with landlords and trying to find jobs and medicine and food is part and parcel of the larger struggles going on in other countries. And we hope to show them that. So what happened with the mural movement is, it's all connected. It's just that's part of it too. The society just got more conservative. And possibly many other artists like ourselves just got frustrated at not being able to paint things that said something other than just, you know, decoration. And one of the things about mural art, public art, is that it belongs to everyone, and people can't come in and buy it and make profit off of it. That's what's going on in art, in the quote-unquote real art world, which is really just a stock market. So that's what it is. I feel a connection to my cave people ancestors when I do this.
You think they live down the Lower East Side?
Yeah, maybe they do. Maybe they do. Yeah, artists of conviction. You don't have to make a lot of noise and stuff, you know, a lot of braggadocio. Doesn't really get much accomplished. If you do it, you don't really have to talk about it, you know?